client, your own team members and your reporting manager is not going to get it convinced, right? Okay, so we will go through some of the slides and then we will come back to this. In the meantime, I have seen some of the chat. Okay, whatever you have put over there. Okay. Okay, now let us try to understand this. So why we have selected this particular topic? See, whenever I'm selecting a topic in a webinar, there is a reason behind it. Just like that, I do not pick up some topic from the thin air, right? Because I sit and think for some time. Okay, this particular topic is more relevant because that is how the industry is currently heading towards. Because if you are working in a hybrid model, you need to be good on both the sides of the fence, like waterfall model versus agile manner, right? And one more thing what I wanted to say is the core project management concepts are not going to get changed, be it a waterfall model or be it an agile manner. Because from my experience, people who have understood the essence of PMP certification and who had really experienced doing projects in PMP certification, those people are able to easily clear PMI ACP. Because PMI ACP is from the same PMI, it's more towards agile certified practitioner, right? So what I have seen is if you're good in traditional, at least you know the basics. Now, little bit of tweaking, little bit of customization, alignment need to be there to move it to the agile based engagements. But if you don't know the fundamentals, even agile is not going to solve the problem, right? So from that perspective, project management is still project management, be it waterfall or agile. And then the third line, agile transformation sometimes fail because people bind all their activities to a single framework. Because sometimes I have seen people saying that, hey, we have implemented SAFe, so SAFe will take care. Yes, SAFe will take care, provided you are implementing it properly as per the principles of SAFe. If you are swallowing or if you are eliminating certain things by our own whimsical fantasies, nothing is going to solve the problem, right? So from that perspective, don't expect a single framework to do your magic. And no single certification program is going to teach you all these particular capabilities. Now, the last point is very, very important. The last point is many people, I have a doubt. Are you people able to view the slide, right? Some person says not able to view. Okay, I'm getting a thumbs up. So Balaji, Venugopalan, maybe you may need to check from your end. Okay, cool. So see, some people say that, okay, can I go for a waterfall or can I go for a agile? Now, from my perspective, that question itself is not a very correct question. Because why? It is not a Boolean value, like can I go for waterfall or can I go for agile? The actual question itself is, to what extent I need to take plan-driven approaches and to what extent I need to take adaptive approaches so that the fit for purpose resonates with the context of the engagement. Okay, let me repeat this line for the benefit of the larger audience. So it is not actually a question of can I go for a waterfall model or can I go for a agile-driven engagement. No, the actual question should be, okay, I have a model, like I have a methodology called a waterfall and I have a methodology called agile. Now, let us look into the ecosystem. Let us look into the problem statement. Okay, and then make a thinking to what extent I can leverage waterfall processes or a methodology and to what extent I need to go for a adaptive approaches. So you need to take the right mix and then blend it over here. Okay. But then before asking it, we also don't know whether the question itself is correct or not. From that perspective, asking question is perfectly fine. But sometimes we also need to ensure that we are asking right questions. Only then you will get the right answers, right? If you're asking wrong questions and then expecting correct answers, it's not a logical one, right? From that perspective, I just want to clarify that particular point. Okay. Now, let's keep going. Okay. Now, these are the knowledge areas, right? Now, in terms of your PMBOK, right? You take either guide 6 or guide 7 or whatever it is. These are the fundamentals. What are they? Integration management, scope management, schedule, cost, quality, which you all know. Okay. It is not that you people don't know all these things, but probably you may not know certain things in terms of implementing these things. That is what I'm going to share over here. Okay, everyone knows all these things, but are you successful in all these things? Most likely not all the people, right? So these are all the PMI knowledge areas given. Okay, now let me ask a layman question. What is the use of this particular knowledge areas? Why are we, why does, okay, what could be the reason PMI given something called the knowledge areas? Go ahead and then put it in the chat. In the meantime, I'm just going through the earlier pings. Okay, so over the period of time, I could see that people who are attending the webinar consistently, your questions are also getting matured, which I can find it out. Because by looking into the question, to some extent, I could make a judgment. What will be your level of the background thinking, what you did when you typed those questions? Good to see that, people are learning a lot, over a span of time. Okay, so what could be the reason for categorizing something called the knowledge areas? Can you just put it on a high level? Look into the areas and you think practically now, if you are doing a project, why do we need to have these particular areas? Okay, I'm just going through it. Knowledge areas helps articulating. Knowledge areas are good to get big picture. Articulating the aspects of a project which requires specific attention from a PM. Okay, good. Needed in a particular. Okay, so let me just give a simple analogy or an example, right? See, for example, most of the candidates have this particular habit. Suppose if you are applying for some role, I'm just giving an example. Let's say that you are applying for a role of a PMO in some company, okay, IT company. Now, if in the interview, the interviewer is asking you, okay, let's say a person by name Shankar. I'm just giving an example, arbitrary name. Okay, Shankar, so can you tell me your roles and responsibilities? If someone is asking like this, do not jump into answering the question, blah, 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 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Some big paragraphs. No, a structured way to respond to that question is in terms of functional ABC, in terms of technical CD, okay, XYZ, in terms of managerial 1, 2, 3, in terms of technical 1, 2, 3, because it is not about you knowing the subject. You need to get a conviction that people are getting convinced that you know the subject. Right? So there is a difference between both, right? So for example, if I'm taking a webinar, it is not about whether Balaji knows Agile or not. It is about how effective Balaji is able to translate his knowledge through this particular webinar to increase the capability of other people who are participants. So always you need to create some logical groupings, right? Functional, technical, managerial. I'm just giving an example, okay? In tune with your experience. For example, if someone is applying for a data scientist role, probably you may need to segregate the profile in terms of data analysis, in terms of data modeling and extrapolation. Like that, you need to create some high level buckets, and within those high level buckets, you may need to position your answer so that the receptivity is actually better. Same thing applies here from a layman thinking of point also. So anything and everything which you do inside that particular project. Okay, what is a project? A sequence of activities which is going to give a definitive end goal or objective, and this sequence of activities has a start date and a end date, which is the PMI definition of a project. Of course, yes, now some of the companies are moving from project to product mindset, and myself have been involved in building productized IT models, but that is a different topic to discuss in a different webinar. But in this webinar, we need to appreciate the importance of a PMI. So anything and everything you are going to do related to the project can be put into these particular buckets, right? If you have these 9 buckets, anything which I can put into it can be holistically put into these buckets, so that it is actually more holistic when it is logically grouped. That is the funda. Now, does this apply for agile engagements? Why not? Absolutely, yes. Same, all these process areas may still apply for an agile engagement, but slightly in a different manner. Because instead of taking a big requirement and then executing it in a phase-gated approach, you are taking a small set of requirements, but then you are still going to, you are still going to do the SDLC, right? That is the fundamental. Okay, so what I have done here is, instead of, see, it will be very difficult. Okay, like at the end of the slides, I have tried to explain the difference. But for now, what I have done is, I have taken scope management as one of the knowledge area, and then let us try to deep dive inside it. Like this, you may need to do for each and every activity. Means what? Traditional, okay, how it is versus agile. So before we go through these slides, right, what thoughts come to your mind fundamentally? Okay, of course, the first slide you can see, that is fine. How do you, okay, when someone says waterfall model versus agile projects, right? In terms of managing the scope of the project. So what thoughts come to your mind? Because this is a very important thing, because in an agile driven engagement, generally the scope is not fixed. Generally, okay. Okay, of course, at a release level, you still need to baseline the scope. That is a different thing. But when we are talking about the iron triangle, which someone mentioned, generally the scope is kept a variable for multiple reasons. Because if you fix the scope, you cannot add business value. Why? Because market is always a moving needle. And because market is always a moving needle, I tend to do the prioritization at a frequent interval. And if I wanted to do prioritization at a frequent interval, if the scope is already fully baselined, where to do the prioritization? So for multiple reasons, the scope is not fixed. Scope is kept a variable. So can you put some other points also? Like in terms of this question, waterfall versus agile projects, how does scope is handled? So what I wanted you to, okay, let me tell, see, I will teach you fishing in this webinar. You guys need to go and then catch the fish. Let me tell how you need to prepare in a smart manner. Okay, in the following slides, I'm just going to explain. But then to begin the journey, if you are trying to conquer all the knowledge areas, it's not going to work out. Now you need to think, okay, if I'm applying for a project manager role for this particular JD, for this particular company, most likely what are all the knowledge areas I will be questioned by the interviewer, right? And out of this 9 or 10 knowledge areas, probably you may need to select 4 or 5, definitely. And then for that 4 or 5, now you need to pick one by one. If it is cost, how does cost operate in a traditional world versus how does cost operates in a agile world? So on and so forth for multiple process areas. Okay. This is one way to prepare. The other way to prepare is, now you need to think, okay, PMI gives a concept called a process areas. Okay. What do you mean by process group? Initiation, planning, execution, monitoring and the controlling, followed by the closure of the project. Okay, we do have slides for it. Okay, somewhere down the line, we do have slides for it. But I wanted you to take a grip on the overall process. Okay, so initiation, planning, execution, monitoring and controlling, and closing. Now, you have some set of activities under it, right? That is what Rita's process chart also tell. And the people who have done the PMP exam knows it very well. Now, what I am trying to say is, out of the total activities under each of the process group, you need to think, okay, which activities I need to selectively plug and play. Okay, for this particular JD, probably I need to prepare more on controlling or more on planning or more on, like, you know, or actually more on initiation. Like that, you need to do some smart work. Okay, how many people understood this? If you understood this, can you give me a thumbs up? What am I saying now? Or you give a thumbs up or you put a yes in the chat. You should not be slogging. That's what I am trying to tell. There is a smart way to read things. Instead of reading the entire book, you can might as well, if you do some smart way of reading, if you read the entire book, let's say it is going to take, it may even take 3 to 4 weeks. Believe me, if you take PMBOK materials, big book, it is even going to take 3 to 4 weeks. The other way to read is, you need to take a lean thinking in this also. Okay, now this is the company for this role I'm going to apply. Now you look into the JD. Clues are already given in the JD. Okay, now one guy told me some companies are actually giving the JD one thing, but they are asking some other questions in the interview. See, we cannot control everything on this planet Earth, but whatever is there in your circle of influence, I am now trying to do. Okay, that we need to understand. But are we doing the right things within our circle of influence? And slowly, day after day, are you expanding your circle of influence? That is the question over here. So the point is, look into the JD. Now, if the JD talks more on strategizing, more on creating a road mapping, blah, 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 then they are going to check more on the planning phase, like the planning process group. Now you need to take the PMI guide or whatever it is, then go through the activities under the planning, selectively plug and play. That is how you can read smartly. If not, even if you read for months together, you cannot master the subject. Okay, I just want to tell over that. Okay, now as Menaka mentioned, priorities on feature sets in an incremental way, request following prioritization technique to be up. Okay, so she is actually talking about continuous prioritization. Okay, now let's keep going with the flow of the slide. Okay, so what I'm trying to say here on the left side is we are trying to document the complete scope at the beginning of the project, whereas here, as you know, people who have done CSM, PSM, those people knows it. We have the product owner. See, let me tell the problem here. Problem is never with the framework. The problem is, if you are taking CSM, like you have a product owner who is owning the product backlog, and you have a Scrum team, which is a self-organized and cross-functional team, at least per the theory. And then you have a Scrum master who is a process facilitator, who is more of a servant leadership role. Life will be very easy, provided all these things which is told in those materials really go by that. Unfortunately, that is not the reality. Because in many engagements, product owners are not contributing to creating visibility on the backlog. And then let me tell you the real problem, because I know the pain of the Scrum Masters, right? Many of the product owners will be from your client side, and you cannot escalate it on your client, right? Because if that product owner guy is from your own parent organization, at least you can influence the product owner by talking to your reporting manager or a lead, all those things. But if your product owner is the business sponsor of the project, or if the product owner is from the client side, it is not commonsensical to escalate a client. Forget about all this agile job career. There is something called a common sense, right? It is not commonsensical to send an escalation mail on the client. If you send it, you will be removed from the project. This is the ground level reality. Or someone make a note that you are not able to work in a very diplomatic manner, and during the performance appraisal, your performance ratings will be going for a down. Okay, this is the reality of the world. That is why I'm saying all those certification is actually good to go to begin the journey, because certifications generally talk only on the happy path scenario. Even in terms of the safe implementation, if the portfolio backlog exists, if program backlog exists, if architectural runway exists, if there is an RTE, if there is a solution trained engineer, everyone is in the happy path mood. But unfortunately, teams are struggling to create visibility. Monday, if you're going to start the iteration, even by Friday end of day, there is no clarity on the user stories in terms of the definition of a ready. So that is where what we need to do is that don't bank upon only the cadences which are recommended by the framework. You need to elevate your level to that level. You need to create your contextual meetings. You got it, right? Don't tell that Scrum is not saying this meeting. Don't tell safe is not saying this meeting. Safe is not, safe is also not saying you not to come up with customized meetings. It is just a framework, right? So once you execute more projects, more engagements, and we also know, right, shu, ha, ri. For you to go to the re state, you should be a master of shu and ha. Only then you can go to the re state. And it's going to take some time, okay? So from that perspective, now we will go through the slides because I just want to set the context of this slide. Okay, so these things you know, right? So in a traditional model, any change after the requirement phase also will may be considered as a change request, but that's not the way in a agile engagement. Okay, now just take a minute to go through it because I'm sure that you can understand the content. So I'm not going to explain it word by word, respecting your years of experience. So just take some time to go through the slide on a high level. That should suffice. So here I'm saying change management is an inherent part of the agile process, right? Okay, let's go to the next slide. And here I have told something important. Projects often include scope blot, unnecessary product features are included out of, okay, something here. But here what happens, continuous prioritization happens and it has been done and tested then and there. You are not keep on carry forwarding it. Now, what is more important, let me tell. See, what is more important in this exercise is, we all know that we have 10 principles or 12 principles of agile, right? Whatever be the number. Now, what you people need to do is, once you are doing this classification between the traditional versus agile, you also need to map it back to the which lines of principles of agile this particular point is going to connect with. Okay, let me just show you what I meant by that. Once I have done this exercise, right? Here I'm saying whatever points I have told in the previous slide is in union with, resonating with, harmony with point 1, 2, 3, and 10 of agile principle. Because you need to still validate these particular principles. If not, you may mistakenly introduce that.